Warning, this episode contains spoilers for Spider-Man No Way Home.
Is your spoiler sense tingling?
We have the power to spoil this for you.
With great spoilers comes great responsibility.
Listener discretion is advised.
In a world where entertainment is viewed as mindless diversion, only good for momentary distraction, one podcast has taken a stand. Thoughtfully engaging the art of our day, dissecting the narrative, and pointing the people back to the greatest storyteller of all. You are about to enter a new world, and you will never view entertainment in the same way again. This is Popcorn Theology.
Okay, I got my sling rain. Okay, Miles is magic. Miles is magic. Miles is magic. Give me Richard.
Oh, hey, Miles, how's it going?
Oh, David.
I have to sound so disappointed, but...
Well, I haven't done an episode with Richard in a long time. I'm trying to get a hold of Richard, and I got my sling ringing and everything. Oh. I'm trying to visualize mm-hmm. the OG host, Richard, and I need to know by what standard to judge this movie. Yeah. So let's just, okay.
All right, well, try it again.
Don't say anything quite, okay. Give me Richard.
What the?
Cinema guy.
Hey, what? Well, Miles, what's going on, man?
Who's this guy?
We just watched the Santa Claus last week, and I thought, you know, if I believed enough and had a little Christmas magic, I could summon the OG host, Richard, to talk about Spider-Man. Well, having the cinema guy is okay.
I was going to say...
I'm kind of the OG. I mean...
He is kind of the OG, so...
Yeah, that's a good point.
I'm from the Cinemagogue universe.
Well, I was going to say, we kind of did the big crossover merger event in a way before Marvel did, because we sort of subsumed the Cinemagogue universe within the Popcorn Theology one, if we want to look at it that way, I suppose.
Yeah.
That's true.
Yeah, and...
Who subsumed who?
I kind of feel like young Tom Holland version of Film and Theology, just inspired by you guys. I just want to be an Avenger, you know? And eventually I get taken up into this grand adventure.
Wait, so from a Popcorn Theology perspective, that makes David the oldest. That means you're Toby. Just saying.
Oh, you want to be Garfield? I was going to say, I thought that if anything, it would make me Garfield, because you've been doing this much longer than I have. I mean, a bit longer. A bit longer than I have. but hey, you know, either way, we'll take it. And so now our listeners might understand why we dropped the spoiler warning so early, because honestly, I don't think that there's any good way to discuss this movie without spoiling it. At least not with any real heft or substance. And so,
yeah, we couldn't even think of a good intro that didn't somehow spoil a part of it. This is one of the most spoilery movies ever made, but it's awesome.
And Richard had ideas, but we actually strung him up over the Grand Canyon for the next 12 hours, so he can't really help us.
Sorry, Miles. That's why you weren't able to get in touch with him. He's in the mirror dimension.
He's strung. strung up upside down in the mirror dimension for 12 hours.
I know geometry.
Meanwhile, we're going to go dive in and Scooby-Doo our way through this movie and find out its grand themes.
For sure.
Because this movie's not mindless.
No, not at all. There's a lot to talk about. And I think that the biggest thing with this movie is that, I mean, it was one of the most highly anticipated movies, at least for me and for many others, of the year. And there's obviously so much that we could say in terms of, you know, sort of the anticipation and our experience with Spider-Man. I'm fairly certain we've covered most of the Spider-Man movies. I don't think that we covered, actually, I'm not quite sure. I know we've covered all of the Holland ones. And Spider-Man 1 and 2, I believe, for the Maguire ones. I don't think we covered any of the Andrew Garfield ones.
Oh, how dare you, sir.
Yeah, well, maybe that's a good way to introduce this movie, because the final installments of both the Andrew Garfield Spider-Man movies and the Tobey Maguire movies were really pretty disappointing to me. Like, I just left me with kind of a bad taste in my mouth, even if they have some good moments in them. I remember this Maguire's third Spider-Man movie was one of the more disappointing movie experiences. I was like, night showing, I was like in teenage years, so stoked, and I just went away being like, oh, they ruined it. And not only that, there's plot points in that movie that retroactively make the first movie worse, in my opinion.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And so I usually leave a movie thinking about it and being excited about what the movie makes me think. But this movie in particular gave me basically the opposite feeling of Maguire's third Spider-Man movie. I came away just thinking about how deeply satisfied I was for so many of the moments in the movie. So, for example, seeing Doc Ock get cured and come back to his senses, just that redemptive arc is just, that was just a wonderful feeling. And in particular, seeing Garfield's Amazing Spider-Man and Spider-Maguire get one more outing, just the way I felt that they should. Yeah. Just the movies I knew was in them, you know, and especially Amazing Spider-Man catching MJ. Oh. I just felt so satisfied. It was it's kind of like the way you feel at the end of some of the arcs for Endgame. It's like when Captain America gets his happy ending, and Tony Stark goes out like an Iron Man. Mm. It's just like I just came out feeling kind of warm and fuzzy and high on the movie. And that's not actually a normal feeling for me. It was just it's just great. All of the feels.
I agree with that. All
feeling film is very proud of us right now.
Yeah. We're giving them some unintentional, although, you know, not ill-advised recommendations. Go check out Feeling Film. I haven't listened to their episode on this, but I'm sure it's full of all of the feels. for sure. So I'm curious on that front. You know, so you got into it a little bit there. And this is going off script a little bit, but I'm just curious with the, of the three Spider-Men, I don't know that we've done much in the way of ranking, on this show, mostly because I don't like it all that much, but this is one that I think we've all probably done a little bit in our minds is of the three, Maguire, Garfield, and Holland. Do you have a favorite? Do you have a least favorite? I'm curious what you guys, where you guys land on it.
Well, I'm happy to dive in there. It's funny, my wife and I were watching select ones, kind of priming ourselves for the possibilities of this film. And we watched Spider-Man 2, which is probably my favorite Maguire film, and Amazing Spider-Man, the first one, which is my favorite of the Garfield films. And of course, Homecoming was been my favorite of the Holland ones up until this film. Although, is this a Holland film? Is it all of their films? It's hard to categorize. So those three, like I realize my favorite Spider-Man films are one of each of them. So it almost makes it more difficult to guess which one is who I like the most. But while I don't think that he got handed the best of the films, honestly, Andrew Garfield to me best represents the Spider-Man that I grew up with. He's from the long, lanky limbs that actually make him look more like the Spider-Man of the comics to even his Peter Parker facial features and things, which look a lot like the 80s Peter Parker that I remember reading growing up. Like, he represents physically, in a lot of ways, the Peter Parker that I most knew. And also, I think in some ways, his movies got some of the best humor that Spider-Man has always has. The way he's cocky and sort of mocks his villains.
Oh, yeah. Man.
There's that scene in The Amazing Spider-Man where he's like, oh, my greatest fear is small knives.
Small knives.
Like there's a cockiness that he pulled off really well that I don't think it's the way they've done Holland is he's a little more uncertain and awkward about himself. And then Tobey Maguire, they didn't write it that way. So,
right.
In many ways, Garfield and the first Amazing Spider-Man movie, up until this film, maybe for me the most gut-wrenching, emotional of all of the films. There's so much happens in that film, and I won't spoil it if people haven't seen that one. But there's a lot of trauma and tragedy, which was always a part of the Spider-Man comics. Kind of conversely, or what do you call it, juxtaposing all the jokes, there was always this incredible heaviness to the Spider-Man comics. Yeah. So, to me, in a lot of ways, Garfield is my favorite character-wise of the way that he's been portrayed. And so it was, as Miles said, extremely emotionally satisfying to see him get a really nice arc in here in a variety of ways to work amidst the other two.
For sure, for sure. Yeah, I can definitely relate to that, because that was one thing that stood out about Garfield when that first came out. I said, they're actually getting the humor closer to right. I agree. What do you think, Miles?
Yeah, it's kind of fragmented for me. The original Sam Raimi movie came out when I was in seventh grade, which was basically a perfect time for a Spider-Man movie to come out. And so in retrospect, it seems a little campy. It was a little campy. But the place it has in my heart is pretty powerful. But I'd agree totally with James about the way Garfield's Spider-Man looks, especially the Amazing Spider-Man comic that was coming out around the time of the Maguire movies. He had that look perfectly. But my favorite movie of all of those is Homecoming. So it's fragmented between the three. I also think that so far, the Spider-Man movie hasn't quite captured well enough for me, like Peter Parker being a nerd that nobody seems to like. I like the original idea of Peter Parker being nerdy, outcast, and then once he puts on the mask, he finally gets to be the person that he's always wanted to be. Because Andrew Garfield's Peter Parker was so cool. He's like riding skateboard through the hallways and stuff. So I always thought, there's no way in high school that somebody wouldn't like a brilliant, funny kid who rides his skateboard through the hallways. There's no way that kid's not popular.
Yeah, no, for sure. That was one thing when I saw the ads for The Amazing Spider-Man that I was like, he's riding a skateboard. No, like he's got to be a nerd. And it's funny because that kind of gets into my, I may be one of the few that I think I've liked each of the new Spider-Man better than the previous one. And that's not to cast shade on the other ones. It's just kind of like gradual refinement. You know what I mean? Because, I mean, like you said, the 2002 Sam Raimi Spider-Man movie, that was such a game changer in so many ways. Now, I mean, X-Men was out, sure. Don't get me wrong. That was also a game changer. But in terms of superhero movies, I was at the target age for that as well. And so Spider-Man's always been a huge, huge favorite of mine. But once Andrew Garfield came out and I actually saw the movie, I said, okay, I think that they did a lot more with this. And I think that in addition to that, we've seen each Spider-Man kind of be better at dealing with the emotional heft of the character, because, you know, you can kind of judge a lot based on the memes that you see. Maguire's handling of some of the more sad emotional moments, I don't know. It just seemed a little clunky. Maybe it's because of the way it was written. I don't know. I certainly can't critique that too much. But just seeing them wrestle with the sadness in their lives, and that's really Peter Parker's character, is the guy who cannot catch a break. it seems like each Spider-Man has gotten better at kind of capturing that. And also, one thing I've appreciated is that they've gotten younger. I believe when Tobey Maguire first played Spider-Man, if I'm not mistaken, he was like 27 or something like that. and Andrew Garfield, I think, was like 22. Someone can look this up and correct me. I looked it up at one point. But Tom Holland was actually like 18 when he played a high school student. And it was just like, okay, he's actually believably in high school. Something I've come to appreciate more and more than like, oh, you know, he's about to get beat up by this guy who looks like he's about 30, you know. in the hallways. But anyway, all that aside, this movie I think is going to be a favorite for so many, because it really seemed to encapsulate the best of each of the three Spider-Men in terms of their character, maybe not in terms of the overall film, but the character for sure was rich in this movie. So there's so much to discuss, and it's going to be tough to keep this one to a reasonably length episode, so sorry in advance if it goes long, guys.
I will say, for me, probably the most emotionally satisfying MCU film since I'd say Infinity War. In some ways, although Endgame tied up, it was 11 years of Marvel MCU movies. This, as you mentioned, Miles, tied up basically 20 years worth of Marvel movies.
Yeah.
With a character who has always been in my easily in my top five, top three characters, right alongside, of course, the one who made the cameo appearance as well.
Oh, man.
Because he's a very good lawyer.
Oh, and dude.
I think that the fact that we keep edging closer and closer to connecting the Netflix shows to the MCU is nothing but sweet joy to me. In fact, it makes me want to go back and watch Daredevil season
three again. I've seen season one three times.
There's never not a good time to watch those three seasons. That is some of the best stuff Marvel has put out is the Daredevil shows. Yeah. And honestly, even...
And he's Catholic. I'll take it.
Yeah, close enough. Close enough.
Yeah. We'll take it. You know, he's in a church. The Christians aren't villains in that whole show. But man, it was great to see Matt Murdock in there, you know, doing his lawyer thing. And if you watch that first season, they definitely meant it at least wink and a nod to be in the same universe as the Avengers. Like a lot of what they were doing was reacting to the event in New York in Avengers. That's one reason why Fisk was able to do what he did, rebuilding his neighborhood.
Mm-hmm.
So they always meant it to be tied together. And then it was like studio politics is the reason why we don't have Daredevil season four already. And that broke my heart because Daredevil was getting even better and better. And this movie, even just in a single scene, found a way to give me hope about Daredevil, as well as take these things that I love from the other Spider-Man movies and capture some of the best of those other movies and make them better. To continue their story. You also get, you know, the Spider-Man, Garfield and Maguire end up kind of being able to be a little bit of Uncle Ben to another Spider-Man. And so it's just great, you know? Like just the classic, here's a hero, here's how to be a hero, we're going to help you struggle to be a hero, let's go be heroes.
You know, I think that this is the movie that I wish I had seen opening night. I saw it like the next afternoon, like Friday afternoon, I saw it. And I really wish I had seen it opening night. But even though it was the next day, clearly several of the people there with me hadn't seen it before based on the reaction in the theater. And I tell you, this really makes me want to see more movies opening night because the reactions, me and then like a few people behind me in the theater were reacting, I would say, appropriately at the appropriate parts of the movie, which is to say, like, way too boisterously at the Daredevil cameo, because there's all this stuff that was rumored. Yeah. And I was sort of telling, you know, I was taking a line from MJ, get used to disappointment, or, you know, prepare for disappointment and you won't be disappointed. I kept telling myself, well, maybe it won't happen. Maybe it won't. And then when you freaking see Matt Murdock on screen, I lost it. I was like, yes. And then with every subsequent appearance that wasn't in the trailers, I was like, yes. But so there was so much about this, kind of like with Endgame. The Endgame movie theater experience is going to be the number one for me in my life in terms of opening night energy in the room. Like that room was electric. And this was close, but anyway, it just makes me miss that, the communal experience of being in the theater. And that's something that we're getting back to for sure. But I'm excited to see that become even more of our culture again. I'm curious though, with you guys, if, you know, we've said a lot of nice stuff about this movie and we're going to say a lot more nice stuff in the remaining part of this episode, but I'm curious if you guys had any nitpicks, anything, you know, sometimes we're a little too, or not, you know, sometimes we can be a little kind to the films and it's worth taking a moment to point out if there's any flaws that we noticed, or anything that just didn't quite agree, didn't quite sit right. And so I'm curious if there was anything in this otherwise fantastic movie that just didn't quite do it.
Let's crush some joy.
No, I thought it was perfect. I'll let you be the killjoy.
Just me? They've seen my notes.
No, I had a little bit about in there.
So put a damper on things.
Was it really just me? Okay, all right,
he's gonna
go
do
first.
One.
Okay, no, David. Okay, fine. I'll do one. I'll do one. I don't know how the Wong that we saw in another recent Marvel movie and what we find out about Wong in this movie really line up. Like, you're the Sorcerer Supreme, but you run around and bet on fight games and hang out with the Abomination. It's like, really? It's like, do these fundamentals really line up? And Doc Strange is sort of bumped out. And it, what was going on at the Strange Mansion seemed a little wonky and out of sorts to me.
Wonky, huh?
Yeah.
Now, agree. Yeah. Wong is just generally an unusual character in terms of, like, how serious is he at any given moment? Varies wildly. Love him. Love Wong in general. But, yeah, I would agree. He was hit or miss.
He gets, you know how some people have plot armor? He gets beat around by the plot for whatever is convenient in the scene for the primary people. But he's along for the ride.
Yeah.
Fair enough.
For me,
there you go.
There were some elements around, like, Aunt May's death that didn't rot. It also, there was also, it ran a trope. Eric George in our Facebook group posted a meme about, you know, guaranteed in a movie there's going to be a time where somebody is going through the plot and then is getting a little pale and somebody reveals that underneath their shirt there's stained blood and somebody says, "You're hurt!" And then they say one more thing and then they die. You know, that trope. It's
right. They're shot in the lower abdomen off to the side. Yeah.
It's like
in the kidney.
She seemed to be walking around pretty fine. I know they were doing it kind of like she's kind of delirious from the hit, but she did a lot considering that what apparently happened was like large shearing of portions of her back that could not have been recovered from. That was like, it was just a kind of nitpick for me. I was like, this happened pretty fast, but I got my "with great power comes great responsibility" line, and I don't really care how it comes. Because
Miles, you have not watched enough opera. People can get mortally wounded and sing for like 15 minutes. So
it's operatic. Maybe that's a good way to put it.
Comic book movies are allowed 5 if it's just dialogue. So that's,
yeah.
Singing, she could have gone on for 10 more minutes. I'm just saying.
But that's me trying to have a nitpick. But the thing is, this movie just made me feel so good that I've just, you know, it covers over a multitude of sins.
That's a good point. Like, and there's a lot that I really just had to sit and think, like, okay, what did I have a problem with in this movie? And honestly, the only thing was, and I hate to even say this, the humor seemed a little too much. The fan service seemed a little too much. I mean, I enjoyed it. Don't get me wrong. I felt very serviced as a fan, but there was just a little more than I don't know. It felt like there was a lot of it that was based around the memes, which I loved because I thought that was some good fan service. It was some good meme service, if nothing else. It was just a little hammy, but again, I had all of the warm feelings by that point too, so I'm willing to forgive that. But Jamie Foxx's Electro, I don't know. He looked so much better. They fixed the costume was great. He looked a lot better in general, although I liked the blue light up Electro in general. Just his cockiness was odd. Especially for him being like a third-rate villain, even in this story, if he had like taken on a leadership role and had that level of cockiness, I think I would have been a little bit more okay with it. Instead, he's like, "I'm really cocky, but also like the minute that you put that little buzzer on my chest, I'm like, yeah, okay, that's fine." I don't know. It just it seemed a little bit like Jamie Foxx just said, "No, this is how I'm doing it," and they just said, "Well, okay, we can't recast you, so that's fine." But again, that's just got to be me.
I thought he was
flaws.
So horrible in The Amazing Spider-Man 2. I guess I was just happy he wasn't that character.
That he wasn't that same.
It did seem like they changed him a bit. I guess that's what turning into electricity does to you. I don't know.
I like the line, "You got to be careful where you fall," or whatever it was.
Yeah.
Man,
that was pretty
great. Into some eels. I fell into some goot, you know. Yeah, all that. Yeah.
I feel like David's given Electro some unnecessary static. That's all I'm saying.
But it was fantastic. We almost had a Sinister Six movie. We were one shy of the Sinister Six in this.
I know, right?
I could have somehow done with one more. I don't know. Like, who could have come back? I mean, Vulture maybe could have come back, bust him out of prison. Yeah. I don't know. Not that we needed more villains. There was a lot of villainy happening. Just something about having.
But it
six.
Actually felt, you know, in retrospect, it didn't feel like too many villains, even though that was a big problem for previous Spider-Man movies.
Right. Mm.
It was almost nice that there were so many that you were like, okay, they all have basically the same problem. Except for even there was some interesting stuff. Like Sandman, he didn't really care about people being cured. He just wanted to get back to his daughter. So he's in the middle of a fight, but he doesn't have the same motivations of other people.
Yeah.
I like that kind of complexity in an action scene where there's there's multiple motivations going on at the same time.
Well, it's something you can do when you have this many movies at a certain point, right? That's what previous movies tried to do too quickly, was almost have two or three villains or almost get up to a Sinister Six in like a movie and a half. You're like, guys, you need to build this like this. You need to have world building, which is something MCU's really excelled at.
Yeah. No, for sure. They had the previous films to work based off of. And additionally, it seems like when you just have them as a team, it's okay. We don't need the full motivation. We don't need a big, scary, bad guy speech from each person. You know, we don't need the monologue, if you will.
Started monologue.
It worked pretty well to have them as a team.
Wait, David, I have a legit. I forgot my other nitpick, just for the fans out, just to show how nerdy I am. my major nitpick, I almost forgot. Doc Ock should have reacted when he found out that that lizard creature was Kurt Connors, because in Spider-Man 2, Kurt Connors and
you're right.
and Otto Octavius know each other.
He didn't react to him.
I mean, he even tells,
right. Yeah.
He tells Peter, he's like, Connors has talked to me about you. Like, he says you're lazy, yeah. but brilliant. And all, like, they're, like, he should have had a moment of reaction and startling. Like, there was no acknowledgement that he knew a Connors, even a different Connors. And that felt lacking. But you know, there you go.
For sure. That's a good point. Yeah.
To get back to something I love before we start progressing through our podcast pattern, I love the banter about Tobey Maguire having organic webbing, because I personally think that makes a little more sense with Spider-Man. Even though Peter Parker is supposed to be brilliant, it's really hard for me to imagine that he came up with webbing on his own as a high school student. That's just...
Well, that's where the Garfield version split the difference, though, remember?
Mm-hmm.
Like, he actually got it from Oscorp.
Yeah.
And he learned how to adapt it from an Oscorp formula. That actually did split the difference. I don't know, though. But if you really wanted it, though, wouldn't it need to come from somewhere else?
Just saying. Yeah. I mean, but it's... I really like, though, that is a natural thing that would come up, because that is something that's really important to Spider-Man. And they're just like, talking about, I'm sorry, I'm curious, you know, because webbing is a daily thing for them.
Yeah.
You know, and it's, you know, they're all basically Spider-Man, but there's these differences, and it starts to make their imaginations go. And then, mm-hmm. you know, Peter sums up Spider-Man 2. He's like, yeah, I did run out of web one time, you know, existential crisis, you know, and that was a whole movie.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I liked, I mean, it definitely seemed like all of the things that people have been joking about and talking about for years made their way into actual dialogue. Like, I just couldn't actually believe I was seeing it. I was like, they're actually making jokes about the webbing. They're making jokes about, you know, this thing or that thing, or MJ being different, or, you know what I mean? Like, they even had the nod to, like, oh, my back is sore. And even the little tiny throwaway line about rent. Did you guys catch it?
Yeah.
Yes. I
would have given anything to just have that guy even just audibly shout. I would have loved to have had it.
I did see a meme about the Sinister the Sinister Six, and somebody made Mr. Dickovich the sixth. That was the joke.
Oh, dude.
Go a little deeper with their banter, one of the lines that really stuck with me was, you know, I always wanted to have brothers. And there was just something it's like, like Peter Parker 1, or I don't know, I guess, who was he? Was he 2 in this? Maguire Peter Parker. You know, he had...
The numbering never made sense to me.
he had loneliness a lot in his character. I mean, Spider-Man always struggles with loneliness. But that line just cut pretty deep, and it was kind of neat. Like, these are some guys who really can relate to each other. I always wanted some brothers.
For sure. Mm. And as a quick aside, before we get deeper into the theology side of our podcast, you know, if you're looking for, maybe not brothers, but something of a community, if you will, there's a good way to access that, right? Related to this podcast, isn't there, James?
Yeah, we don't necessarily have the Spider-Verse, but we do have the patron saint-verse of popcorn theology, which is where a whole bunch of us from different movie and theology universes can sling ring our way into hanging out online. And in fact, our patron saints, you guys know, I mean, maybe the fact that we have some Garfield omissions and and haven't covered all the Spidey movies, maybe next time we let you vote on the episodes, which is about every fourth episode, you guys could pick. Maybe that's something to come into the running, is to fill in those gaps on the Spidey spots that we don't have. So we do have an exclusive Facebook group for our patron saints. So if you want to join, you could jump in there with them and start to rally cry, if you will. I think there are some that are still die hard to get us to do It's a Wonderful Life. So maybe you, any Spider-Man lovers could go in and try to hijack that for just as little as $1 a month or more. Hey, as much as you want to help us steer this ship, we'd certainly love to have you.
Absolutely. Now, and all we don't talk about this much, but the funds do go back into promotion of the podcast, and and they make this essentially a free hobby for us. We're not sitting on piles of cash related to that. But as far as the exclusive group, there's also another way to be part of an exclusive group related to the Patreon, and that's within our Discord server. So we have a Popcorn Theology Discord server, which has its own exclusive Patron Saints channel. You can still join the server if you're not a Patron Saint, but we have an exclusive channel just for our Patron Saints. You can also follow us for more content on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. And it's a great place to interact and engage with like-minded believers related to film and theology. So definitely check those out.
And in case you're just walking around looking only like a cool youth pastor.
Nah.
You know, probably some of you are youth pastors.
Nothing wrong with that. Nothing wrong with that.
Prove to somebody that you have a uniform underneath, that you really are Spider-Man, that you really are a popcorn theologian, you could wear the merch. We got Popcorn Theology stickers, Popcorn Theology shirts. I've worn that shirt so many times since it came. And my wife, when my wife sports the Popcorn Theology merch, man, it's like in high school when somebody wears your jersey. Feels wonderful. The best podcast in the world. Okay, man, that's a little. I'm just pumped. I'm pumped on the merch the same way I'm pumped about Spider-Man. It makes me feel so good. And you can remind people that you are not a mindless consumer.
Absolutely. And wear that out to the theater, too. That's the other cool thing. Like, we were talking about the communal experience of seeing this in theaters. You know, how great would it be to see like a whole line of people in Popcorn Theology t-shirts? Eventually, you got to ask, like, what in the world is that? I've had a lot of conversations out of the stickers and out of the t-shirts. I don't know if you guys have, but I've had a lot of people ask me, like, what is Popcorn Theology? And it's a great way to have those conversations. So definitely consider doing that. Consider supporting us. Subscribe, rate, review, do all that stuff you do with podcasts. And we'll come back after the break with more on Spider-Man Into the whatever this movie
is
called.
No Way Home.
No Way Home. There we go.
This episode of Popcorn Theology is brought to you by Missionalware. Missionalware has a large selection of high-quality apparel, drinkware, art, and more, all from a Reformed Christian perspective. Check out missionalware.com and tell them Popcorn Theology sent you.
Thank you for listening to this episode of Popcorn Theology. If you want to hear more from us, subscribe on iTunes or your favorite podcast catcher.
Also, follow us on Facebook and Twitter and share this episode with your friends.
Assuming you have friends. To sponsor more content like this, consider supporting Popcorn Theology through Patreon. Then you'll make some friends.
For just $1 a month, you can have friends. You can become a patron saint and be added to our exclusive Facebook group where you can interact, influence, and vote on future episodes of the podcast.
Well, let's get back to the episode. All right, we're back. We've changed out of our civilian wardrobe and webbed it to a dumpster, and we've got our theology spandex on, and we are ready to go with some more Spider-Man and talk about, maybe we should begin with some philosophy. What do you think, Miles?
Yep, time for some of my philosophy classes to pay off. Okay, so this movie talks a lot about possibilities, like what it brings together. Possible iterations of a character, which reminds me of a philosophical argument for the existence of God called the modal ontological argument. Are either of you guys familiar with the ontological argument for the existence of God?
Mm-hmm. Is that like the mirror universe where Doctor Strange does the... No, not quite.
But when you think about it, it might feel like you're in the mirror universe.
Honestly, that's how I feel anytime I think too deeply about philosophy. So I'm glad it's not just me.
Yeah. So this one could get a bit tricky, but there are different arguments for the existence of God. There are some that reason, you know, from the nature of the world. We might call those cosmological arguments. There are some, like Richard is a pretty good proponent of the moral argument from God's existence, is the by what standard is a shorthand version of the moral argument for God's existence, which is, you know, if God doesn't exist, objective morals don't exist because we are just, and, you know, just atoms reorganizing themselves.
So that would mean with great power, that would mean there is no great responsibility with great power then.
How could there be responsibility if we are just atoms running into each other? There's no duties. There's nobody to be responsible to. Mm. And so any time a movie talks about grand moral responsibility, about the best the secularist can get to is responsibility to your tribe, to your species, to being the type of person you want to be, something like that. It could be kind of deep, but not deep, true responsibility, which is something we could talk about a little later. But that's one thing. Like Spider-Man, with great power comes great responsibility. I think that taps into people's Christian conscience, knowing that there's actually some higher calling that you're called to. And so that's an apologetic, I think, for even Christianity, even found within the famous line in Spider-Man. But to get to the philosophical argument I'm talking about is the ontological argument. So ontological arguments, or it's kind of like the conversation we had on the WandaVision episode, idea of identity metaphysics. Ontology is what is the nature of some being. And so in the 12th century, there's a guy named Anselm of Canterbury who came up with the first version of the ontological argument, which basically reasons from the concept of God to trying to prove God's existence. And so a lot of people don't hold this version of the argument, but it just goes, God is the greatest conceivable being. And then that's the first premise. The second premise is, it's greater to exist rather than not exist. Therefore, God exists. And so he tried to reason from the concept of God being a maximally great being to his existence. And so philosophers for the last 900 years now have been taking down this argument and reshaping it until this century. We have what's called the modal ontological argument, which is why I'm even bringing it in to our podcast. Modal logic is a type of logic that's based upon what could possibly happen. So if we want to talk about something that didn't actually happen but could happen, you know, like what if Kennedy wasn't assassinated? That might be a type of modal experiment, a thought experiment.
Right, we have a whole Marvel concept. We have a whole show, right? What if? There you go.
What if? That's the whole deal. So exactly these kind of ideas is the reason why a show like What If works in your mind is that you are doing modal Marvel logic or modal Marvel experimenting. Because there would be some stories where if it was so different, you'd be like, no, that's not really Doctor Strange. That's not really Iron Man. That doesn't work. You know, that's not... And in terms of modal logic, you just figure out what is possibly true. And so there are some philosophers who say, who argue from this concept of logical possibility to make a stronger version of the ontological argument. And this is interesting because if you have a philosophy-minded person, you can kind of bait them. You can say, do you think it's even possible that God exists? And if they say yes, then you go, yes. Oh, then I have an argument for you. You know, it begins with the premise... It's possible that God exists, then God's in some possible worlds. Premise 3, if God exists in some possible worlds, okay, then God exists in all possible worlds, because it's greater to exist in all possible worlds rather than just some. Right. Fourth premise, if God exists in all possible worlds, then God exists in this actual world, because this is a possible world. Premise 5, if God exists in this actual world, then God exists. So this is a logical argument, so it's not based on scientific data or experience, that gets you from the idea of if God possibly exists, then he must exist because he's a max perfect being. And this is an argument that makes philosophers, atheists and Christians alike really wrestle. And it's hard to if you're following with this just listening to my voice, I will understand if you feel like you're in the mirror universe and it's messing with you.
God shows up and he's like, "Hello, Peter."
But exactly, actually. So, because if this argument works, because it's talking about possibilities, about possible worlds, this is because God has a feature called necessity. He's a necessary being, which means unlike all other beings that could possibly not exist, so you, me, Spider-Man 1, 2, 3, Norman Osborn, if it's possible that they exist, they are contingent beings. You know, they might not exist, but they possibly exist. Hmm. And so this argument is strong enough to, it gets people to the horns of a dilemma in terms of God's existence. Either he exists necessarily in all possible worlds, or in all universes, or it's impossible that God exists. So it forces the atheist to not be like, "Oh, I think God might not exist." They have to make the argument, it's impossible that God doesn't exist. So it's a really interesting logical argument. For our purposes, if you're not following all that, it's interesting to say that if God is a necessary being, then he exists in all possible worlds. Therefore, God is the God of every version of Peter Parker. So if Alvin Plantinga's modal ontological argument exists, then God would exist as God in all of these multiple universes, no matter how you conceive of what the nature of the universes are. Either they're bubble universes or separate realities or separate dimensions. God would be in all of those things if maximal perfect being theology, if this argument holds. And so I know that's a mouthful, but it's just this really interesting piece of kind of obscure philosophy. It's mainstream if you're a philosopher, like a professional philosopher, but God is a necessary being.
Well, what I'm picking up from this, Miles, if I'm understanding you correctly, then all of this stuff that Marvel's been doing, whether it's Loki or a little bit of WandaVision or Doctor Strange's movie, upcoming movie, The Multiverse of Madness, all of this talk of possible worlds is a potential conversational ground for the Christian then. Because all this idea of possibilities and variance gets into the idea of talking about the possibility of God. So right there, maybe not just the Spider-Man movie that we're talking about right now, but Marvel's whole latest delving into this new dimension kind of opens up perhaps maybe a place Christians like that listen to the podcast could learn. Maybe it's time to dig in and understand that a little bit, because it might be the right time for conversations like that.
Yeah, basically what you're saying is that you have the capacity or the power to have these important gospel conversations with people related to this movie. And with such power, of course, comes great responsibility.
To bring in some conversations.
Which is itself a biblical concept. If you know who the good that you ought to do and do not do it, to you it is sin. I mean,
yeah.
but yeah, we have the capacity to share the gospel with people. And, you know, I'm curious how many of us listening to the sound of my voice right now have actually had an opportunity to share the gospel based on a movie. I'd wager it's a smaller percentage than we'd like. And it's happened far fewer times than I would like to admit in my own life. And so I hope that that's something that we take a bit more seriously. And this could be a really great way to do that, to have those apologetic discussions with people in an approachable way. Because honestly, films have such tremendous ability to make us grasp difficult concepts. I mean, on a less evangelical note, the concept of time dilation, beautifully illustrated in the movie Interstellar, is really difficult for people to get their head around. But if they've seen Interstellar, then I know that I can say, okay, you've had this, you at least have a concept for this. I can work on that. So, you know, this is the same type of thing, which, you know, you maybe haven't considered multiple universes all that much. However, have you seen Spider-Man No Way Home? Because even in the trailers, even without getting into spoilers, you can ask if they've considered multiple universes. And whether they have or haven't, it's a good fertile ground for beginning those conversations.
And like there are consistent across all of the more comes great responsibility is something that the Marvel universe is arguing is within the fabric of existence itself, not just this particular universe. It's not just relative to this Spider-Man. It's something that cuts across all universes. And I might argue, cough, cough, that's because God is a necessary being. He would exist across all universes. And he's the Lord of all universes, all multiverses, everything. Mm. He's a necessary being. And so it wouldn't be, you know, it might in a conversation be like, I wonder if they would have different versions of Jesus dying. That's a crazy thought. Is it even heretical to consider what that would be like? You know, maybe the Chosen should do a...
Oh, there you go. The Chosen crossover with the Jesus film and the Passion. Yeah. No, that's bad ideas.
That's bad ideas. That's
I think that it's interesting. So you're talking about consistent characters across multiple universes, God being one of them. Would that mean that J. Jonah Jameson would be another? As another essential character between the different universes.
It would not matter what universe you're in. Maybe every human being, every version of myself would sin and fall short, would mess up, and would need redemption. That's an interest. Like, people have played with that. C.S. Lewis's Space Trilogy had ideas of planets that had creatures that hadn't fallen. Maybe it's something that happens within the population of any set of creatures that are made in God's image that are free to not love him. You know, that's some interesting stuff that comes close to home.
So God is a necessary being and Peter is a necessary screw up.
What's interesting in this movie is that, so Peter screws up big time, but his motives are still pretty good. It's just, he lets in a tiny sliver of selfishness, like compared to how much he gives. But this movie is almost like, with great power comes great responsibility, to be really consistent with your selflessness. So he's just like, oh man, I don't want to deal with the weight of what happens when the truth gets out about who I am. And maybe, and you know, it's affecting people that I love. Maybe I can appeal to some magic and undo this.
Yeah, and ultimately, I think you're right about it being only a sliver of selfishness, because we don't really get the full picture in the trailer of what his motivation is. But in the movie, you do. It's that it's affecting the lives of people around him. And, you know, you could argue about how much of it was really that he just wants to go back to when life was simpler. And I think that there was certainly a bit of both. But what's fascinating to me is, as this movie ties in characters from all of the different Spider-Man iterations and the iterations of their villains, you really get to see a lot of those themes brought back and played with. One of the great ones is what we see in Green Goblin's warning to the Maguire version of Spider-Man in the first Spider-Man movie. And we really see this a couple times throughout the films. And it's a common theme throughout the comics as well, is that, you know, basically he's saying that you've chosen the way of the hero. And they found you amusing for a while, the people of this city. But the one thing that they love more than a hero is to see a hero fail, fall, and die trying. In spite of everything you've done for them, eventually they will hate you. And we see that in Spider-Man 2. We see that in this film as well, that the people have turned on him, that they've ultimately taken the side of the accuser of Mysterio, and that's where we're at is in this setting where the people have now turned on this hero to the point where he's one of the most recognizable faces in the world. And he even has another great, I mean, this movie would not have worked, I don't think, without J. Jonah Jameson, because you have this bulldog going after him, which as just a very quick aside, one thing I've appreciated about the Tom Holland Spider-Man movies is that they've really kind of brought Peter Parker, I think, in a lot of ways, into the 21st century. He's not just like a nerdy guy who's getting beat up by the jocks anymore, like it's the 1960s. Like, the people picking on him are fellow nerds. In the same way that like 21 Jump Street sort of showed how times have changed in high school, we see a kind of similar thing here. I also liked that J. Jonah Jameson is not a newspaper editor anymore; that he's now this sort of fringe online news profiteer, kind of with like an Alex Jones type bent. It's such a believable thing now to have somebody go so hard after one character, one person, and have that be their entire career. I wonder where we may have seen that. So it was just fascinating to me to see, like, wow, this iteration has brought so much into the 21st century more so than the previous versions. But ultimately, you know, we're still at the point where Spider-Man is hated by the people of the city, even though he's the friendly neighborhood Spider-Man. And so you're right. He turns to magic to fix the problem. And
which is, I loved how they made that pretty understandable and underscored it for us too, because I think sometimes it's easy to judge heroes. It's a lot easier to judge Tony Stark. Dr. Strange finally realizes at one point, he's like, oh my gosh, you're a teenager.
Yeah.
Like, of course this is teenage logic. Of course he didn't even think to call MIT to plead his case before he went to Magic Solution. So I think we can give Peter a lot more leeway because you're watching an adolescent trying to find their way with way more power than they should have at that age. And that's where Spider-Man has always kind of been a metaphor for adolescence and puberty and kind of like all of the things hitting you that you're not ready for. And hope for the Christian, hopefully, then it's also for someone raised as a Christian, it's that time where parents are hoping that they're actually inculcating their faith and getting equipped to deal with things, that they're learning from a wise sage and not necessarily an enabling Doctor Strange in this case.
Yeah, that's just more power to be played with, you know? But
yeah,
in the end, the effort that Peter goes through reminded me of this verse in Ecclesiastes that hits me pretty hard. It says, "Do not say, why were the old days better than these? For it is not wise to ask such questions." And there's just a certain amount of wisdom in not spending so much of your time wishing that the problems you're facing now that are new or weren't there. You know, it's not wise to spend too much time thinking about the good old days is another way that another Bible translation takes it. I think there's a lot of people who could learn from that. And so Peter, you know, he's stuck in why were the old days better than these? And these days really are tough, but he turns to magic and he does it so quickly that he ends up causing all these problems. And Dr. Strange is fixing him with the spell and all of a sudden he goes, but wait a second. What about what's going on now? What about MJ? What about Ned? What about Aunt May? What about Happy? And the spell is getting all wrecked in the middle of things.
Yeah, and he's thinking about things in the moment, and that's the funny thing to me is that like it really. And again, this is where we buy it with Tom Holland. We buy that Tom Holland is a teenager, even though he's like 22 now or whatever. We can buy that 27-year-old Tobey Maguire. I mean, who by halfway through the movie has graduated and is like living in a loft in New York City. I don't buy the adolescent logic as much from him as I do from Tom Holland, who's like, oh, wait, I haven't even thought about this thing or that thing. And that's not to knock adolescence. Yeah. It's just, you know, you've lived a smaller percentage of your life. And so every week is a bigger deal to you than it is to a person in their 50s. So it's, a 3-week relationship is like an enormous amount of time for a high schooler. Whereas when you're 50, 3 weeks you don't even remember it.
Right. Ned has that strong reaction too, because he's a teenager confronted with the idea that, oh my goodness, am I going to betray my friend? Right. There's that moment in the movie where he's just listening to other people and like, oh, my best friend betrayed me. Oh, am I going to be the guy in the chair that betrays my best friend? And like, these are kids. They're not emotionally equipped to really process all of this as of yet, as if even most adults are. But but here you have these people dealing with stuff that some of us have never even had to grapple with. So it's fascinating that they're put into that crucible.
And that we also, I mean, there's even been a little speculation online about what's going to happen with Ned in the future. The way that this movie ends, it's not impossible that was teeing him up to become a villain in the future. I who knows? Who knows? I don't know. but it's definitely interesting to think that he's, and we'll talk more about this later. He's got to start from square one now. It's wild what they did with this movie, like the amount that they were able to accomplish. Now he's completely back to broke, listening to police scanners and making his own suit at home. It's just
they did it. Wild. A great job that they with that off. Where they took him from, because he was so powerful at the end of the second of No Way Home, Far From Home, because he had he had Stark technology. He could make a new suit with the fabricator. He's got the support, theoretically he has Stark's fortune, or at least like the Edith, whatever remnants are there from that. It's like that eliminates a lot of his challenges. But this movie found a way to leave the Holland Spider-Man, like where you picture him in the comics is poor in that little ramshackle apartment listening to police scanners, just trying to fulfill the responsibility he has because of his great power. It's just, I was pretty impressed with that, how they landed him in a familiar spot, even though it's a crazy plot.
Yeah. Mm, absolutely.
Now, before we leave adolescence, though, I would say that an interesting note about this movie is that there is one character who is adolescent, but actually exhibits a lot more character and development than the others. And I know technically they say oftentimes, women develop earlier than boys, but here we have an emotional maturity is shown in MJ, which is, she's not perfect. I don't know that I agree with her pessimism, right? But she also is she is equal, if not more unselfish than Peter.
Yeah.
Yeah, she's great. She's very, very supportive. I was at the point watching this movie like, she would make a good wife. That's really what I was thinking at this point. You know, she discovers this rejection from MIT, and the grief hits her, and then she stiffens up and says, I wouldn't change a thing.
And this is where I'll double down on what I said earlier about each Spider-Man improving on the previous ones. I think that each love interest, MJ, Mary Jane, I should say, to Gwen, to Michelle MJ, I think each has improved in so many character aspects. Mm-hmm. I loved Gwen Stacy, and not, in no small part because she was played by Emma Stone. But...
Yeah,
I think that there's definitely a lot there that you're right. She's become very mature, and I even give her weirdness in Homecoming a pass because she was definitely an odd character in Homecoming, but they were teeing her up for more in the two subsequent films. With that exception, I think that each film the love interest has gotten to be a stronger character that in this case is incredibly supportive and great and. You know, who knows what's going to happen in the future with this, because he's got to start from square one with both of them or not, or walk away from those relationships entirely. If they even continue with this Spider-Man, which I don't even know what the plan is.
No, I would agree and disagree. I would say best chemistry, Garfield and Stone.
Yes. Dated in real life.
Best character.
Yeah, I agree.
Best character, Michelle, definitely. I mean, she should be furious with Peter for so many things. And like, there's that point in the movie where he hides stuff from them and doesn't, all she says is something like, next time, let us know so we can help.
Yeah.
You know, she could have dressed him up once. She could have dressed him down completely. And she let him know it wasn't okay, but also just said, like, next time you need to know better and do better.
Mm-hmm. That's one of those things that really makes a marriage work is when like they have you in their crosshairs. You messed up. Like, you hurt them. You failed to live up to your responsibility to them. And they let you know, like, this isn't okay. But just next time. It's forgiveness, right? And Ephesians 4 talks about our relationship with one another. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. And so she's obviously not flowing from a love of Christ, but that's that kind of that virtue that she shows in this movie. And it's just great. I really was like, she seems ready to marry Peter. Like, this attitude, this is how you be a helper comparable to Spider-Man.
Sure. I mean, and then we even get her, and it's not just that we're saying that she's a strong character because she backs Spider-Man on everything, whereas, you know, the Kirsten Dunst MJ really gave him a ton of pushback all the time. It's that she's also, I mean, that's not part of it, but it's... But we also see that she sticks up for him. She understands him. She defends him to supervillains, for goodness sakes. You know, when Electro is asking him, like, well, why didn't he just leave us to die? She says, that's not who he is. You know, I know him. She figured out who Spider-Man was. She was the only one to actually figure it out rather than be told. I don't know. I think there's just a lot to like about MJ.
And at a key plot point, she's the only one who she knows him enough to know where he's gone.
Yes.
To bring the others to go get him. Like, She doesn't just have a relationship. She actually knows the person that she's in a relationship with, to a degree that is maybe even better than he knows himself in some ways. So, yeah, she does a great job of, and of course now that's all been rewound, and she doesn't know who he is anymore because she got a bump on her head, and he has to pull a Peter Parker and not want to put them in danger.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah, exactly.
but that speaks to his love, not only for his friends, but I mean, this movie bears out his love isn't just for his friends. Mm.
Absolutely. We see that he's concerned about the people that have been, in a sense, entrusted to him, these villains that are only in his universe because of his screw up. And he has to decide what to do with these five villains who have stumbled into his universe, and how to deal with that. And I guess you could ask that question. Are they even his problem or his responsibility? Of course, the guy who sees 14,501 different possibilities says, no, that's not your problem. They're going to die. It's OK. You know, their lives are of no value or of no importance in the grand scheme of the multiverse. That's the Doctor Strange level perspective. But Peter has a pretty different perspective of these guys, right?
Yeah, he has this boots on the ground care for life just because these people are people. He recognizes maybe the image of God in them. And Spider-Man in this movie, like, just the biggest virtue I saw him exemplifying in this movie. If I was going to show, like, a little boy, you want to see an example of love of your neighbor or love of your enemy, watch Spider-Man Noah. It's just incredible what he's willing to sacrifice for the sake of these people. That this is the kind of radical choice that Jesus is asking us to make when we follow him. On enemy love, I tell you, love your enemies and pray for your Father in heaven. He causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. If you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Are not even the tax collectors doing that? And if you greet only your own people, what are you doing more than others? Do not even the pagans do that? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. And so this is an important way of describing this verse, be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. A lot of Christians, I think, have used that as a cudgel against themselves to talk about trying to be perfect, morally perfect. But what this verse is talking about is love everybody like the rain that falls on everybody. Like Peter Parker tries to love anybody who comes across his path. Love them all and be willing to pay the price to love these people. It's this brutal love that he exemplifies in this movie. It's just so great.
Yeah. Well, and credit where credit is due, I think, as you mentioned, the loss of Aunt May, right? I mean, he is willing to buy into Doctor Strange's pragmatism until May really stresses that, you know, here is this person, like Osborn's come to her, obviously a villain who is in the frame of repentance, looking for help for where he is and what he's done. And she's willing to extend it to him, which then means Peter extends it. And just like Uncle Ben putting his money where his mouth is, like, she's the one. Peter shouldn't have to experience guilt later when she dies, because she's ultimately the one, like, she modeled it. She entreated him to do it. Like, she brought him into that. And so even in that, I do think it gets complicated, and I don't want to. I saw some interesting articles that I agreed with and didn't agree with on this article or on this issue. And, you know, there is a time where sometimes, I know, like, officers of the law, right? You face the best way to love neighbor. There's really no other imminent situation solvent except to actually stop an enemy with lethal force, right? I mean, like, these are the issues that, like, Spider-Man. I've always felt it was a little off for Batman sometimes to, you know, how many people has the Joker killed? And, like, there is a point where I think that you can talk about counting the cost, and that you've actually loved hundreds of neighbors less or improperly by allowing someone to prey upon them. And so there's a weird balance that goes on there. But in this movie, you literally have Osborn, you have Ock, you have folks legitimately who have been, even Electro, sort of dropped into a collider against his desires and will. You have all these people who were twisted by circumstances, that their pleas and desires for help, or even when they're in their dark modes and not desirous of, it puts a much better light on why you would risk neighbors or even the loss of your aunt, because both of you are willing to to model that like Christ does. Like this movie does kind of go down the center of the road and gives us reasons why, reasons which maybe I don't think happened with the Batman and the Joker, but reasons where in this film show that, like, yeah, this is somebody trying to embody the heart of Matthew 5. And when admittedly it does get tricky, right? Like, how do you love that? How do you love all your neighbors in the midst of this chaos? And what's the equation there? And, yeah, it's so hard.
And it does seem to be just doing the best you can with what is right in front of you. Like, Doctor Strange was almost correct. It just turns out that Peter and the other Peters are able to fix these guys before sending them back. But if they weren't able to do what they were doing, you know, Doctor Strange, what is the weight of these few people versus other image bearers, millions, billions, trillions in these other multiverses? So there is time and a place for that kind of cold calculation, kind of like Kelso in Scrubs versus the doctors, right? You actually do need people who can make those grand calculations. But in terms of you, Christian, you person, with great power comes great responsibility, what do you have the ability to do?
Yeah.
Let's start there. And you may even be called to bear a price that is beyond what seems like your duty.
Yeah.
In thinking about this movie, I thought about, so there's a certain number of responsibilities we have as Americans. You know, you got the Bill of Rights, and rights entail duties. So if you have a right, I have a duty to protect that right.
Hmm.
And there's a libertarian streak in me that says, okay, as an American, you're only able to make a claim on my behavior this far, you know, in terms of me protecting your liberties. But Jesus calls us to do something even farther. Jesus is like Aunt May, like, there's a difference between your rights, what you deserve under the law, and what Jesus is calling me to do under the law of love. You know, owe nobody anything except for to love one another.
Yeah.
Something like that in Romans 12. I don't have it on my... And so Peter, because he has great power, his responsibility underneath the moral law is huge, both as a scientist and as a superhero. And this movie just presses him, just hammers him under the duty to love somebody who's in front of you and what it means to be Spider-Man, and seems to give this quiet with everything you have. That's the thing that these people have in common, is they have great power, and they use it to fulfill the responsibility they have under the, I think it's very biblical law of love, to love your neighbor. And so you see them, they turn to these villains who are here.
Yeah. Right.
Because they died fighting Spider-Man. So battles to the death, heal them in any way that he can.
And that's, you know, that's an interesting thing too, is that it's really something that we haven't seen as much of in this iteration of Spider-Man, is that was always sort of the go-to thing in the cartoons, at least, was that the villains would die, but never at Spider-Man's hand. They would die because they fell off a roof or because, you know, something had happened to them. It was never his responsibility that caused them to die. But they would end up dying to tie the story up in a neat little bow. We don't really get that with the Vulture. The Vulture is still out there. And I guess the exception, of course, would be the Mysterio, who dies. I don't know. It's messy in a way. But what we see him trying to do here is to help redeem these guys, and ultimately, he gives the other Spider-Men a chance to redeem themselves in a way. But we see a physical restoration in the case of Flint Marko or Sandman and Max Dillon. We sort of see this sort of pairing, that both weren't careful. Yeah, got to watch out where you fall, right? Or however they said it. And, you know, so these two guys have not, you know, they essentially just need to be separated from the thing that is causing them this damage. And Dr. Connors, too, in a way, just requiring this physical separation, they kind of played down his power, his God complex and his power hungriness for this movie to make it kind of neater, which I totally get. One of the weaker villains compared to the others. But I did also notice, I don't know if Max Dillon has a doctorate in the storyline, but if he does, then that means that Flint Marko is the only villain without a doctorate. We got Dr. Connors, Dr. Octavius, Dr. Osborn. Anyway, just throwing that out there. And then we see that there's a need for a mental restoration. We see a similar pattern with Dr. Octopus and Green Goblin. Both are tormented by these other voices, and they have to be sort of separated from them in a way. You know, Dr. Octopus has the very simple fix of the chip, which I love that they just kind of fixed that in this, you know, because it was as powerful as it was to see him by will overcome them at the end of Spider-Man 2. I love that scene where, you know, he's overcoming this force that's been controlling him. We don't see, and when we see Osborn struggle to do that, but ultimately they both needed help from outside. They both needed this fix. Yeah. And yeah, so much could be said about Willem Dafoe's performance in this movie. But I thought it was beautiful to see an attempt to restore these villains. Not to justify them per se, not necessarily to say that they are not bad guys, that they're the victim of their circumstances only, but to say, these are the things about you that are broken. What can we do to fix them? I thought that was a very, I don't know. I just thought that was a refreshing take in a way. What did you guys think?
Yeah. I think that there's a good way to watch these movies as a Christian and be like, I am Norman Osborn. Is a pretty strong one, like the struggle of the flesh and the spirit, and having somebody who chooses to love me in spite of my sins, both against everyone else and against them and against other people who love, you know. There's a lot of that, you know. This is a good movie where you can hop yourself inside of different characters and be challenged by what they represent. And so I think there's a lot there.
I think that there is a great value in seeing both of those things happen. It's like as a society, we had a lot of, you know, white hats shoot the black hat stories. And I remember even as a younger man watching Batman the Animated Series when they first humanized Mr. Freeze. And it's like, oh, okay. I love the way you put it, David. He's not justified in this, but he's obviously broken and now operating in a sinful manner. And I think we have to remember in these stories that we're the Mr. Freeze or we're the Norman Osborn. We're not the triune Spider-Man that are actually attending to the problem. We have a trinity of Spider-Men that actually then heal the broken ones. I think there's a danger when we go too much either direction, when all of them are redeemable and all of them get saved, or when all of them are black hats and get put down. I think we have to remember our gospel. It's like, okay, God is going to redeem some, and God is going to let justice land on others. So I think a good juxtaposition, maybe even as we've seen in these movies, right? I mean, the vulture gets saved by Spider-Man, but we're not really sure what his disposition is at the end, per se. We're not really sure where he's going to go with that. And then we saw Mysterio, basically, his own stuff fell on his head and kills him. And now we have this movie where characters get redeemed. It's like, I like that we have several different scenarios over the course of these stories to where, oh, some of both happens. Because that's what I see in the gospel, right? There's going to be some who are redeemed, and then their names are in the book of life, and there are some who their deeds are going to fall on them because they're outside of grace. And I think Christians need both those stories to sort of balance it out. We don't believe in universalism, that God will somehow make space and redeem everybody. It's only those that are under the atoning blood of Jesus, or that redemptive work in faith and repentance, belief. So I like that we get, throughout these Spider-Man films, a nice cocktail of all these different pictures. But I how satisfying and sweet, on top of all the other brotherhood and hugs that go on in this movie, yet the sweet redemption of a wealth of these villains is, I mean, that's that portrait of what we hope to make. We're going to see a bunch of broken sinners that were healed, redeemed, and changed by Jesus all coming together. But, you know, every tribe and nation and tongue, well, in this case, every corner of the multiverse. They're coming together from different Spider-Verses.
Yeah.
and they've all been healed. Like, that's a cool thing.
Well, I can't help but think of the Apostle Paul, right? In his prior life as Saul the Persecutor. And I want to say it's Ananias was the man who was tasked with going to, is that right? The guy who was sent to go heal him. And he was essentially like, are you sure? I don't know if this is a good idea. you know, and I can understand that. That seems like a pretty good illustration of that struggle that some here are having. Like, well, we should just take them down. Why would we try to restore them? Then we see ultimately that it was all part of God's plan, that the Apostle Paul was used by God greatly in spite of and because of the darkness in his past. And, you know, I think it's fascinating too that with this movie we don't only see the restoration of the villains, we see some restoration in a sense come to the heroes as they have to face their own failures. Something that the Spider-Man stories have always done a great job with is to humanize the hero, to show their struggles, to show how, sometimes it seems like they just can't catch a break, but ultimately they have to just kind of keep going, through life and deal with things as they can. With Tom Holland, we see, you know, he's dealing most pressingly with the death of Aunt May, but also with the consequences of his actions on MJ and Ned. No, you don't have a villain seeking them down and hunting them in the way that we've seen in the previous versions, but we do see a similar sort of survivor's guilt in a way with Tom Holland. Additionally, with Garfield's character and Maguire both dealing with the death of Uncle Ben, and with Garfield, that heartbreaking loss of Gwen Stacy. And then ultimately with Maguire, as he mentions, the death of Harry Osborn in his arms. Basically these guys have each lost so much, and we see an attempt from each of them to redeem in a sense in this context and in this story. And there was a quote in the movie, and I'm trying to remember who said it, that everyone deserves a second chance. Do you guys remember the origin of that quote?
It might have been repeated. I can't remember. Maybe MJ?
I remember it being said.
MJ? Yeah, that makes sense. I feel like anyone could have said it, Peter or MJ, but I just didn't know for sure who that came from. I'm curious what you guys think of that phrase.
Yeah, it's one of those phrases that doesn't quite sit right with me. Maybe it's my Christian upbringing is whenever anybody starts talking about what they deserve, maybe it's my political libertarian streak. What do you mean you deserve a second chance? You know,
you're entitled.
I think you're entitled. Because you might have rights, but my duties only go in so far as protecting your rights. And does somebody really deserve a second chance? And so I thought about our framework, just wrestling with that quote, you know, receive, reject, redeem, you know, what kind of category does this put in there? Strictly speaking, I would reject that. I don't necessarily think that people deserve a second chance, maybe from God's perspective. But as a Christian, it's like, if I'm not willing to give other people second chances when God has given me the second chances that I don't deserve, that is silly and unchristian and actually disqualifies me for the gospel, according to Jesus' words, if you're not willing to forgive others. And so I think there's a certain horizontal logic, and, you know, we can receive that. But there's, like, if you're saying everyone deserves a second chance between me and God, you'd be like, well, maybe not. So it's just one of those, it's a theme in this movie that's run through. MJ gives Peter second chances. All the Peters give the villains second chances. And it's that theme that runs through, but it's like comfortable.
This is one of those things where I think I can't receive it, but I won't reject it. I think to redeem it, I would take a tip from the comic vocabulary itself. I think the better way to look at it is how amazing to get a second chance. Right?
You are amazing. And I wouldn't just You're tie amazing. That.
I wouldn't just tie that to Amazing Spider-Man. Yeah. I would tie that to Amazing Grace, right? The whole idea of getting a second chance is getting unmerited favor, right? Like that's the very definition of grace is unmerited favor. And that's why we have the song Amazing Grace. I think it was R.C. Sproul that was talking about the sad. It's almost an MJ kind of lament, you know, kind of if you're expect the worst type of thing. But you know, like, people tend to first see grace as amazing, then expected, and then entitled. Mm. That's like that. So like we move from the spectrum of recognizing it as amazing with great gratitude to then we go from to then, you know, with great grace comes great entitlement, sadly. Like it's just like that. That's not what we want. Mm. So I don't deserve a second chance, but how amazing that there is a story in which someone gets it, like this one, or how amazing is it that there's a God who gives it? Like that's where the story should blow us away. Spider-Man is amazing because he's doing something that our amazing God does with his amazing grace. Mm.
Fantastic. Amazing. Yeah. One might say. No, for sure. And that's the thing. Like I can definitely relate to the reticence surrounding the word deserve, for sure. But then again, how many times in the Gospels do we see our commandment to forgive others because of how greatly we've been forgiven? Yeah, I think of the man who was who was forgiven much, but by the master, and then he went out and he was wringing the guy's neck who owed him a far lesser amount. You know, and we see that ultimately how ridiculous is it for us to hold unforgiveness in our hearts? You know, we even see Peter trying to put not this Peter, Peter. Peter, Cephas Peter, Simon Peter, none of these Peter, Peter one, I guess you could say, trying to put a number on it and say like, just how much do I need to forgive? Seven times, you know, I'm going above and beyond here. Seven's pretty good. and Jesus does some not geometry, but some other great use of math on him there. 70 times seven, in order to reveal to him that no, you're going to be forgiven much once I, you know, go to Jerusalem, and therefore you're going to have to forgive much. And I know you don't want to count to 70 times seven. So I'm just going to hope that you don't count that high and then cap it off there, that it's ultimately our forgiveness should be in response to how greatly we have been forgiven. And so, in this case, we see that these guys get that second chance, whether they deserve it or not. They're granted this opportunity, both the actors to redeem the characters that they portrayed in many ways, and the characters themselves. I'm curious for you guys, if there was a moment in this movie that you thought was the most, like, maybe if you teared up a little bit, or maybe it was the most emotionally resonant for you in this film. And I'm just curious if that was just when we saw Matt Murdock's face, or if it was something else.
By far for me, it was the way Garfield Spider-Man looks at MJ after having caught her.
Yeah.
It's like gratefulness and regret and like all mixed into one. And like, so the other Spider-Men were just like, no, man, you are amazing. And he's like, yeah, I needed that. And he kind of half believed it. And then he got to have a moment that spoke to his deep wound. I guess maybe it's kind of like after we've been talking about Peter denying Christ, and then Christ comes back and says, Peter, do you love me? You know, affirm me three times after having denied me three times. It's like, you have this great soul wound, you know, that's left because of one of your great failures. And he has this moment that, oh man, it just sticks with you. It was unexpected too.
Yeah.
Right. You expected Peter to save the matching MJ.
Well, no, see, I actually thought at some point, because I did see in the trailer that she was falling. So when they had Garfield's character, I actually wondered if we'd see him actually somehow save her but die in the midst of it. In fact, I actually thought we might see Toby die when he got stabbed.
Yeah.
I was wondering
if... Well, and I thought that might be appropriate. He would have followed Harry, right? That's the way Harry died, saving him.
Yeah. So I wondered if they were going to actually give us a death, which... If you mentioned, I think earlier, David, it was a little hammy. Like if there was one moment where I could have seen them doing a very Spider-Man thing and having one of them pass on. I mean, it's something we've seen in other combo team-ups of similar ilk without getting too spoilery. But right, to actually have a Spider-Man die would have been fairly appropriate. So I, that was the only thing that, but you nailed it, Miles. There was nothing more. I'll go out on a limb and also say I think of the three actors, I think Garfield is the most comfortable with his emotionality.
Yeah.
And conveys something with even just a subtle expression in or one word sometimes that I think is superior to the others. Superior Spider-Man. That's another comic. His performance was spectacular. Anyways.
Like, if you want to see something that's great, I've watched his speech that he gave at Comic-Con when he was the one saying that he's the next Spider-Man. I've watched it like a handful of times over the last few years.
Oh, wow.
Where he shows up to the like a microphone like he's asking a question and his mask off and he's, I'm Spider-Man. I've loved this character forever. I needed Spider-Man when I felt like a wimpy, skinny kid. And like, this movie... I felt gave him another shot.
Have you seen the groundswell for a Spider-Man 3?
For him?
There's quite online groundswell going on right now to actually give him the third movie that he never got. I think based on the success of this movie, Sony probably should consider what would it look like now? Like they have a multiverse.
Yeah.
They could tell an older Toby movie with a married MJ and him married with MJ and a kid. Like they could tell Spider-Verse stories now.
Yeah.
And they could cash in.
They could do it. They could even potentially cross it over. I knew they weren't going to do it with this movie, but it does make me wonder, could you somehow cross it over with Into the Spider-Verse? Like I know it could get awkward in terms of animation, but could you not have a live action Miles Morales come in and have him kind of like look at his hands what's happened? I don't know. Like that might be so cool. That might be a little much, but at the same time, we have Nicolas Cage. We could have Nicolas Cage in a live action Spider-Man.
Well, either way, even if they had an animated version of the Garfield universe or the Maguire universe, like I could see they could work it a bunch of different ways and probably make it function.
Yeah.
But of course then one of our Peters, not to forget one of our other Peters, but there's one who's been forgotten, right?
Right. Yeah, exactly. He's willing to sacrifice. And again, it's fascinating that we see this repeated theme of, you know, being neglected by the people that you've sworn to protect, from the original Sam Raimi trilogy and from Spider-Man 2, I believe it is. Aunt May has this speech that I think made it into the trailers and it was repeated a lot. I believe there's a hero in all of us kind of thing. Keeps us honest, gives us strength, makes us noble, lets us die with pride, even though sometimes we have to be steady and give up the thing that we want the most, even our dreams. And that's something that we see each version of Peter having to do at some point, but we get to see more of it in terms of Tobey Maguire's Peter Parker, because he's regularly pushing away MJ in order to protect her. No. And this is a line that he later repeats to Dr. Octopus, in order one to convince him to destroy his own creation. I mean, not maybe in so many, with that intention, but in order to convince him to come back basically to redeem him. And he's giving himself the courage to let MJ go. And he's trying to work up that courage to let MJ go again. And this notion of giving up your dreams, perhaps we see the greatest, I don't know, maybe one of the greater sacrifices in Holland's character here, because he's not just giving up one person. He's giving up every relationship he has ever had. I mean, I thought that was odd. It's not just forgetting that you are Spider-Man. It's forgetting that Peter Parker exists. So no one that you know, you now have nobody in your life. He's given up everyone. Yeah. No cousins, no distant relations.
Like nothing. If somebody's trying to comfort you during a hard time, usually it's like, but you have, that's what he's given up. You know, he's laying down his life for his friends, laying down all those memories for the sake of them. It's one of the most spiders that could be done, given that repeated trying to keep the people that you love safe, you know, from your enemies, from the problems. It's just great. And then ultimately I like that he gets the strength to do that from the other Spider-Men who are channeling Uncle Ben. Like one thing I like about this movie, so I like that we got with great power comes great responsibility back. And also because in this universe, the other Uncle Bens or this multiverse exist, it makes me calm down a little bit about this Peter Parker never having the Uncle Ben moment, because I love the Uncle Ben, the father figure who lays his life down. I felt like the Holland Spider-Man was missing that, but I can have my cake and eat it too because of multiverse. And these guys, they dive in to be Uncle Ben for him. Yeah. When he's been loving the stranger, and now
exactly.
Green Goblin turns himself into his enemy, and he really gets to test whether he's going to love his enemy. And his brother in the Spider-Verse, his brother in the Spider-Man mantle comes in to stop him from channeling his grief into revenge.
Mm. Absolutely.
It's awesome.
And I think, I was torn on whether Holland would have his own Uncle Ben moment or not. I was okay with not having to see a third within however many years version of Uncle Ben dying. You know, it's kind of like watching Thomas and Martha Wayne die. Like, how many times do we really need to relive that trauma? But, you know, it could have been done in flashbacks or in some sort of reference, you know, but he's never referenced. There's a monogram on a bag that I noticed at one point. So he has a bag from his Uncle Ben, but they never mention him. They never talk about it. And it's very, you're right. It's awkward. It's almost awkwardly missing, but this almost made that seem intentional now that he didn't have that, but it was brought from the other universe for him to have that figure. It was beautifully done. And ultimately something that you can tell was needed from both the Garfield and the Maguire Spider-Man, that they are also in need of a way to mentor someone. And that, you know, we were talking about these resonant, powerful moments. I think for me, MJ being saved was a huge one, but also when Holland's about to kill Green Goblin and Maguire stops him and he gives him that look in the eyes. Oh my gosh. I was so like, just floored. I was so excited that Tobey Maguire was in this movie for that moment, if for nothing else, just for that, just to say no, buddy. Yeah. And it didn't have to say a word, didn't need a word, just the look. And that was fantastic. He was helping him like, no, I understand. Trust me. I've gone there. We see Garfield's mentioned that he's gotten vengeful and rage filled as well. And it was also, I think, so resonant because of the forgiveness that we see Maguire extend in Spider-Man 3. And yet another reason I'll defend this movie is that we have a character who is shaped by the loss of his uncle and spent years dealing with that grief. Ultimately, finally get the chance to look in the eyes the man who caused it, the man who was ultimately responsible for his uncle's death, and under no compulsion, with no reason to do so, to just say, I forgive you, and to let that go. I mean, it was a beautiful moment at the end of Spider-Man 3. You can say there were some less beautiful moments earlier in the movie. That's fine. But I can't bring myself to forget that forgiveness of Flint Marko. And then we see that kind of come to fruition here in No Way Home, where he says, trust me, I've done the unforgiveness. I have blood on my hands from this. And I've forgiven. I've done both. This is what you want. And it was wonderful. It was an excellent portrayal, and ultimately resonant with what we see in the Christian family, right? Not just the Spider family, but the family of Christ, right?
Yeah. And there's like, this movie will remind you, like, let's take the analogy that the Spider-Man mantle is like being called to be a Christian. It helps older Christians, younger Christians, figure out how to relate to each other. There's a time and place for older Christians to step in and counsel, as well as just straight up stop the younger Christians from giving in to sin. You know, as brothers in Christ, Christianity is a with others religion. It struck me really hard the other day. I've cited the Lord's Prayer a bunch of time, and it wasn't until maybe this year that I realized that it's, if plural, you know, our Father, this is how you should pray, disciples. There's like this implication that we should be praying together. You know, this is the pattern of prayer that Jesus sets down for us is a with others type of prayer. Or similarly in Galatians 6, 1 and 2, this is what Maguire Spider-Man reminded me of. Brothers and sisters, if someone is caught in sin, you who live by the Spirit should restore that person gently. but watch yourselves, or you also may be tempted. Carry each other's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ.
Now, that's true. It's so powerful. And ultimately, flies in such opposition to so much of what we see in the world today, which is, you know, that's not my problem. That's not my job. You know, even as you were mentioning earlier, your rights exist, but they don't infringe on this or that or the other. And this notion that ultimately Christ calls us to fly in the face of, carry each other's burdens.
Yeah.
You know, and why would I do that? Why would I want to carry your burdens? They're your burdens. That's your problem. This is why the gospel is so transformative in our lives. It's not because we just need some slight correction. It's because it's complete course transformation from the way that we tend to operate. So it's, you're absolutely right. I think that's a fantastic illustration of that.
What are you talking about, man? Hashtag not my universe.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's so crazy. He had so much to gain by sending them away. Right. But they are.
Yeah.
But they were in front of him and he had the power to help. So he chose. And then eventually the Spider Brothers, I always wanted brothers. Oh, that line.
Yeah.
They came in together to support one another and be who their Uncle Ben had always called them to be.
Mm.
And yet, I wonder if they remember him.
I know. I had the same thought.
Do Peter Parkers forget Peter Parkers in that spell? It'll be, who knows?
You can't extend that too far. They can't forget themselves, right? They're just sitting in padded rooms with complete amnesia in their own universes. Oh, no.
did appreciate, too, that there was a cost at the end.
Yes.
That Peter had a cost. Whether or not he tells MJ and Ned again, like they're even bearing that, like he lost his aunt. And he has made the sacrifice, which forever changes all his time with the Avengers, forgotten by the world, all the gifts he's given to the world and what he's done so far, all erased. And I think that it's a sobering but necessary reality as Christians. Like we can do things together, and we know our expectation in this life is that we don't always get a happy ending, right? The happy ending will be in the kingdom to come, but this life, whether it will be somewhere between, Job and
I don't know.
I was gonna say who had it better.
Right? I had it a lot better than Job. Job.
I'll be somewhere Job between and Job and Solomon.
Christian. Yeah,
somewhere between Job and Solomon, and Solomon in his old age totally compromised himself too. Like there's like rich or poor. Like there are costs to what we do, and I like that it didn't shirk from showing that either. It wasn't a totally happy ending. It was happy with all the sacrifices it achieved, but there's still some cost to be borne in walking through the weariness of this world sometimes. And that's a nice Spider-Man juxtaposition that I think speaks well to the Christian experience as well. Like, oh, that's right. I may have some amazing success, may have some amazing brotherhood with my Christian/spider friends. But there'll be costs too. There'll be things that age me, or there'll be things people will never know. And now Peter's in that place where, I mean, boy, the left hand doesn't know what the right hand is. He has done so much for the world, and it has no idea. So he has no occasion to have, he's humbled by that, right? I mean, that's sometimes a good thing for a Christian. Like his deeds are now completely done in secret.
Yeah,
which is also something that God would have us do to keep us humble and make sure the glory is for him.
Absolutely. I mean, he's called to reject everything at this point and yet to continue on with his purpose. And fascinated and excited to see what happens next for Holland Spider-Man. And who knows, maybe for the other Spider-Man. We'll see. time and social media pressure will tell, I suppose.
But I do feel like the time for the spell of wrapping up the podcast has come upon us.
Yes. So
we can delay it no longer.
Yeah, absolutely. This has been a super long episode, but I think that those who saw the movie and made it this far understand why there was not much of a way to cut this short. And so so much more discussion to be had out of this. And I just want to encourage you to do that wherever you talk about movies. But one great place to do that is on our social media channels. Remember, you can follow us on Instagram and Twitter, but a great place to interact is in the Patreon Facebook group, as well as the Discord server, which has its own exclusive Patreon channel within it. And so join us there, have discussions. There was a spoilery, I think it's still there, a spoilery thread where you could go and you can actually mark spoilers. So if you're worried about other movies being spoiled, don't worry. Discord can be a really good place to help avoid that as well. And yeah, just, you know, if you appreciated and enjoyed this episode, just consider sharing it with your friends on social media, rate and review us on iTunes or wherever you listen. That's always appreciated. And yeah, just we can't wait till next time and we'll have more discussions then. So in the meantime, keep engaging media.
Wait.
What?
I think I got this.
Oh, go for it.
With great consumption comes great mindfulness.
Yeah. I mean, it's not wrong. You're not right.
Or to put it another way, right?
Don't be... Wait, now I forgot it. Crap.
You are not...
Now you cast a spell. I can't remember my tagline. No.
I broke the pop culture theology multiverse. Until next time, remember... You are not a mindless consumer.
There we go. You brought me back. Thank you, James.